morning. Father, we thank you right now, oh God. I'm going to be reading scripture this morning coming from Psalms 91. And the scripture reads, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh for thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways." Thank you for the blessing of the reading of the word. Amen. Father, we come before you this morning, God. We come before you, Father God, with humble hearts right now, God. We thank you for the opportunity to have breath in our bodies, to give your name glory, honor, and praise on today. Father, we dare not take the time to allow the rocks to cry out for us on today. God, you have been too good, Father. Your mercy endureth forever. God, as such as a time like this, we're calling on your name, Father. We find refuge in who you are, oh God. Lord, we just come before you, giving your name all the glory, Father. We just come just one more time to be in the midst, to give your name praise and worship you, oh God, for who you are. Father, truly you are worthy to still be praised during this time. So we open up our mouths right now, God. We give you praise, oh God, for who you are, Lord. Father, we dare not take this time and the opportunity not to glorify who you are, God. So we come before you, ushering you in right now, God. We ask that you create in each one of us a clean heart, Father. Renew our right spirit within us, oh God, that we will be what you would have us to be. God, we forever will give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. Right now, we give your name glory, honor, and praise for who you are, God. We are so great, Father. There's nobody like you, oh God. We can look high and we can look low, oh God, but there is no other God like you, Father. So today we give you glory. Today we give you honor. Today we give you praise for who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Come on, put those hands together.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Come on, put those hands together. Hallelujah. 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 We bless your name. We bless your name. We bless your name, Jesus. You're worthy. Come on, help me magnify him. Help me make him large in this place. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, yes, yes. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Put those hands together. Yes. Glory to God. The Holy One.
The Holy One.
You are.
You are.
The Living Word.
The Living Word.
You are.
You are.
The Center.
The Center of my
prayer. Yes.
You are.
You are.
The Son of God.
The Son of God. You are.
You are.
The Solid Rock.
The Solid Rock.
You are.
You are.
The Center.
The Center of my prayer.
Yes. You're the Lover.
The Lover of my heart.
keeping us safe. You're keeping us safe. Yes, Lord. Your mercy endured. Your mercy endured. Your mercy endured forever. So right now we bless you. Right now we bless you, Lord. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are. When we did not deserve it, your grace and mercy followed us all day long. All day long. Glory to God. Yes, God. We did not come to play no games. We came to give Him glory. And we came to give Him honor. So help me magnify Him. Help me glorify the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Thank you. Yes. Glory. Yes, Jesus. Am I? Yes, God. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
Yes, beauty in my brokenness. I'll count true love instead of pain. There's
From under, going over. You come
from under. We're coming out from under. Going over. We're going to make it. And put those hands together for our pastor, Pastor Johnson. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
So God of all glory, God of all honor, the God of all praise, at this time, Lord, we just reverence you for the sensitivity of your spirit. Father, even though we are not in the church building right now, collectively as a congregation, reviewing our service from our homes, wherever we may be, Father, I pray that you'll keep us all connected by your Spirit. So, Father, today as we transition from the worship into the Word, dear Lord, we ask that you'll give us ears to hear and a heart to understand. Father, bless those that are in need of you right now. And we trust you for everything. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning to everyone. Thank you all for tuning in, joining in with us here this morning as we're having our 10 o'clock service, 10 a.m. service. We're praying for you. We are staying connected with you. I just want to let you know that even though we are away, we are separated or segregated, that we still have each and every one of you in our minds, and we're thinking about you again. Now, just as a reminder for all of the information that you need in regards to what we are doing as a church, from our small groups, from anything that we may be having, even church news that we want to disperse, definitely check your emails or meet us on our website, www.insidenewzion.org. In addition, you can also check our mobile app, too, for communication that way. So, at any rate, let's get into the Word for this morning. So, if you meet me in Genesis chapter 25, Genesis chapter 25, and we'll start in verse 29. I'll give you a minute just to find that right where you are. Genesis 25, we'll start in verse 29. Amen. So, the Word of God reads, Genesis 25, starting at verse 29. And Jacob saw a pot. Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, "Feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint." Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, "Sell me this day thy birthright." And Esau said, "Behold, I am at the point to die, at the point of death. And what profit shall this birthright do to me?" And Jacob said, "Swear to me this day." And he swore unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage, and he did eat and drink, and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau, as the Bible says, despised his birthright. Just for a few moments here this morning, we're going to talk about the subject of our message here, is don't be a sellout. Don't be a sellout. Let me pray for you one more time. Father, I pray that none of us this morning will leave wherever we are unchanged. In Jesus' name, amen. So now, Jacob and Esau, this is a very popular story that many of us have read either through Sunday school or we've learned at some point in our lives. It's a really good one for us to dig deep into. But now, just to give everybody some context, we had Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham, as we know from Genesis 12, is one that God had sent out and said, if you trust me, if you have faith in me, that I will send you off into a land to where you will be prosperous. So Abraham and his wife Sarah did that. And so they had a son, Isaac, and Isaac ended up having a son, Jacob. This story we're taking us here this morning is with the middle boy, which is Isaac. So now Abraham had a son, Isaac, and Isaac was married to a woman named Rebecca. Now, in the fact that they were married, they eventually got pregnant. And what the Bible says, as we see in the beginning of Genesis chapter 25, is that Rebecca was pregnant with twins, with two babies, that there were two babies inside of her womb. But now what the Bible also tells us, which is interesting, is that those two babies inside of her womb were at war with each other. Now, one of the babies was named Jacob, and the other's name was Esau. Now, Jacob was, as we see through the Bible, represented God's people. But now Esau eventually represented the Edomites, or the enemies of God. So now, there were two nations, as we see in the Bible, that were living inside of Rebekah. Now, one reason why I always like to bring up that point is because even us as believers, we have two nations or two natures that are living inside of us. We have the new us, the new you, that became alive as soon as we submitted our lives to Christ. So as we were reborn, then God gave us a new life. We were a new person. We were a new creation. However, even though we were reborn and we have a new us or a new you, you still have the old you that is lingering around. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, it says, for the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other. And the Bible says, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. So now we have the old us, or the old me, and I have the new me that are living inside of me, just like Rebecca had two nations inside of her womb, and just like her nations were at war with each other's. The old me is at war with the new me all the time. Now, this is the reason why, even though you're new in Christ and you love the Lord, you still have things that make you struggle and are trying to pull you back out of the new life that Christ has called you into. So now the question comes about, if that's the case, the old me and the new me, which one will win? That's a good question. And the answer to that, the one that will win is the one that you feed the most. So if there are two nations inside of us, we're feeding our spirit or our flesh. And whichever one that we feed the most is the one that will win. That's the reason why I want to say to all of us as believers, we need to think about the things that we watch. We need to consider the places that we go. We need to think about the conversations that we have, because it is either going to feed our flesh or it's going to feed our spirit. But again, whichever one you feed the most is the you that you will see prevail. So now going back to the story, the Bible says two nations inside Rebecca's womb. But now it also said that out of the two twins, that the older would serve the younger. That the older would serve the younger. So now Esau was the oldest twin. Jacob was the younger twin. Just to give you a little bit of insight about both of them, Esau, as the Bible describes, was a hunter. And if I can summarize everything that the Word of God says about Esau, he was what we would describe as a man's man. He was a man's guy. He was dirty. He was dingy. He was brave. He was rugged. He was rough. Jacob, on the flip side, is what we will refer to probably as a mama's boy. He stayed close to home. He liked to bake cookies. He liked to bake goods. It's a little bit about the both of them. But now in the story, Esau came from the field. And the Bible says that he was faint. And saying that he was faint meant that Esau was extremely tired and he was lethargic. And so Jacob, who had been cooking in the kitchen, The Bible says that he had prepared some pottage, and Esau, with his tiredness and him being out of energy, said, I am about to die, talking to his brother Jacob, and he said to him, give me of something to eat. So Jacob said, I will give you something to eat if you promise me that you will sell me your birthright. So now here Jacob is being a little bit deceptive because his brother is hungry, he's tired, and his brother self-proclaims that he is about to die. But Jacob's response was, I will give you what you are asking for. However, you must give me your birthright. Now, here's what the Bible says is significant about the birthright. The first thing is, the birthright was given to the oldest child of the family. And it came with a double portion. So when the parents would die, there was an inheritance that was left. Whoever owned the birthright, which was rightfully given to the oldest child, was to receive a double portion of the inheritance that was left by their father. We see this in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 17, where it says, but he shall acknowledge the son of the hated for the firstborn by giving him a double portion of all that he hath. The first thing is that with the birthright comes a double portion. The second thing is that they were to get rights to the family property. So again, everything is about the inheritance. So as the inheritance was to be divvied out, the property was rightfully given to the one who owned the birthright. But the third thing also was that with the birthright came the right to be considered the priesthood of the family. So the birthright was nothing to play with, and it was something that was cherished, something to be cherished, and was something that you were to hold close to. However, Esau, in coming from the field, was exhausted. Life sometimes will leave you exhausted. Just think, from all the bills, from all the chaos, from all the reports that come from the doctor, from you being a single mother trying to care for your children by yourself, from all the pressure that you're under to perform at work, to the struggle that you're having with you and your spouse or your friends or anybody close to you, life will leave you exhausted. Now, what we must be mindful of is that exhaustion will make you compromise your judgment. Just think about how many times that many of us have made a rash decision or a bad decision simply because we were exhausted. Now, this is the reason why doctors will tell you that you need to get 8 hours of sleep. Because within that 8 hours, they're telling you that your body will get its appropriate amount of rest so that you can perform at the best of your ability. So now Jacob, or Esau, here he was tired, he was exhausted, and because of this exhaustion, he agreed to sell his birthright to his brother Jacob. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 16, it says, lest therefore be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, whom for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. All of this happened because of the pressure of the moment. If there's one thing that the enemy is trying to get us trapped into, is the pressure of the moment. The pressure of the moment. Because the pressure of the moment will allow your judgment to be cloudy and will allow you to do some things that you never thought you would do. Going back to the beginning, that's why we always have to feed our spirit. Because at the times where the enemy is inundating us, trying to come to us to convince us to do the wrong thing or to convince us that we are exalted. If you're exhausted, if your spirit man is stronger than your natural man, then you'll always make that right decision. So here's the thing. We have to be careful not to give in to temporary pleasure, because temporary pleasure can give you a lifetime of pain. That's why we can't sell out. Don't sell out on what God has given you for anybody else. Now, the other thing that I want to give to you here too is that people that live for the moment, that live just for the here and the now, these are the people that generally end up crashing and burning. And as God's people, as me as your pastor, there's one thing I want to communicate to you is don't give up to anything temporary, or don't live in just the moment. Because if you live in just the moment, you can make a decision that can destroy the rest of your life. That's about Esau, but let's talk about Jacob. So Jacob made this deal with his brother and said, I will give you this food, this pottage that I've made, if you will sell me your birthright. And Jacob, by his name, means deceiver. Jacob, by the very nature of what his name, how his name is defined by the dictionary, it means deceiver. But Jacob, his name was eventually changed to Israel. So it was from, his name went from the deceiver to Israel, which means God's special treasure. So that means that regardless what your past is or any mistakes that you've made, God can still use you. God used Jacob, even though he was deceptive, for a purpose that was greater than him, regardless of the mistakes that he has made. We see this throughout the Bible, that God can forgive and he can use anybody. Abraham lied and said his sister was his wife. But guess what? God forgave him and God used him. Moses killed a man. God forgave him and God used him. David committed adultery. But guess what? God forgave him and God used him. Samson fell for a weak woman and God forgave him and God used him. Paul abused Christians. God forgave him and God used him. Peter denied Jesus Christ 3 times. God forgave him and God used him. Barrington Johnson, I won't tell you what I've done, but guess what? God forgave me and God used me. So what does that mean? That regardless of what we've done, God can forgive us and God can use us. But let's make this thing easy and then let's not sell out what God has given us for a temporary moment of pleasure that can lead to a lifetime of pain. I'm going to close with this. If there's anything that you need to sell out for, you need to sell out for the will of God, for the will of Jesus Christ. If there's anything that we are going to sacrifice, everything that we have, we have to sacrifice for Jesus Christ. Let me just pray with you real quick. So, Father, I'm praying for somebody here in the name of Jesus right now that could be on the brink of making a decision that could wreck their life. I pray, dear God, that they won't make a decision out of their natural, but they'll make it out of their spirit, man. I pray, dear God, that they won't give in to any temporary moment of pleasure that can lead to a lifetime of pain. I pray, Father, that they'll recount your will and they'll think about what thus saith the Lord, and your voice will be stronger and mightier than any other influence that they have in their life. Now, as we continue to pray, as your head's bowed and your eyes are closed, I'm going to give an invitation for somebody here today. In the event that you are at a place in your life to where you can sense Jesus Christ calling your name, calling you exactly by your name, and he's trying to call you into the kingdom, maybe you've been wrestling with it or maybe you've been confused, but you recognize the voice of God in your life right now. If this is you, I'm going to extend the opportunity for salvation to you right now in the name of Jesus. Bible says if you confess with your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that you shall and you will be saved. The first invitation I want to give you is the invitation for salvation. The second invitation I want to give you is an invitation for rededication. Maybe you've given your heart unto the Lord at some point in your life, but now you just want to say, God, I want to start all over. God, I want to hit the reset button. And I want to do it all over again. The amazing news for you is that the Lord will accept you back as if you never were. Now, if this is you, if you want to receive salvation, if you want to rededicate your life, what I'm asking you, immediately go to our website, find our contact information if you don't already have it, call the church. I will send somebody to call you, to pray with you, and to welcome you into the kingdom of God. If this is you, don't allow these moments to pass. This time I'm going to bring forth Adrian, if you can lead us to this altar portion of our song. Here today. Reminder, please meet us on our website as often as you can, www.insidenewzion.org. Also, a reminder to check your emails. I definitely want to make sure that everybody's getting connected with a small group that we're having at least 4 to 5 times a week. So listen, we want to stay with you, we want to stay connected with you. Just know that we are still praying for you and with you in the name of Jesus. Now, lastly, is anyone that you have in our church, anyone that you know, you have their contact information, please make sure that you reach out and call somebody. You never know who is in need of just a conversation, and you can literally be the one that can change somebody's day. All right? Listen, God bless you. We look forward to seeing you next week. Now unto him who was able to keep you from falling, maybe since you fall us in the presence of his glory, and we'll see you in joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.